Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Coldness of Objects by Panayotis Cacoyannis, narrated by Dan Calley. For my mother, who will always be here. 1. Monkeys. Undaunted by any fear of flatulence or heartburn, Mr. Rubens was thoroughly enjoying his mid-morning coffee.
"There is a time and a place for everything," he was fond of saying,
and as a matter of ritual, not routine, an obvious distinction. This was certainly true of the orderly way in which he chose to live his life. Always served in the same gold-rimmed porcelain cup, never more than half full, carried through from the kitchen at the centre of a massive silver tray whose handles formed the antlers of ivory stags, making up with grandeur for the necessary rationing of caffeine that prevented more unfortunate mishaps. Mid-morning coffee was had in the sitting room at 10:45, and at 5:06 in the afternoon, a small part of the mice and tea service would be extracted from the curved wood Scandinavian sideboard, piece by bone china piece, and the necessary number of its hand-painted menagerie of monkeys, the teapot's 3 chimpanzees, 2 macaques on a cup, and 2 more on its saucer. A pair of spider monkeys sprawled across the milk jug, and a spectacular orangutan wrapped around the sugar bowl would be transported on the same silver tray to the kitchen and carefully arrayed across the kitchen table as though ready for a whirligig spin in a circus parade. Mr. Rubens was already 68 when he took the decision that he must forsake sugar, his very sweet tooth notwithstanding. But he was too fond of the orangutan to keep him locked away with the side plates baboons and the cake platters gorilla, and so the empty sugar bowl invariably made an appearance. After warming the teapot, Mr. Rubens would fill it with a scoop of the finest India tea leaves and just enough hot water for 2 cups. At 5 o'clock exactly, he would pour a dash of milk into his first. Before, after, and in between mid-morning coffee and afternoon tea, Mr. Rubens liked things to unfold in as regular a fashion as possible. This was not to say that even now, at a little over 70, his life lacked excitement, or that he was afraid of taking risks. Not at all. If that were the case, for example, he would have long ago given up coffee. No, it was rather that he liked to plan his excitement, just as he liked to plan everything else. In the exquisite comfort of his favourite armchair, an original and signed 1960s amoeba, Mr. Rubens contemplated his surroundings with pleasure. He was a man of impeccable taste, if he said so himself, a real connoisseur. One leg crossed over the other, rather sprawled in the vastness of this singular piece of design, he basked in the warm, affectionate light of the fiberglass lamp that loomed overhead, suspended from the ceiling by invisible threads. Mr. Rubens held his cup in mid-air in a satisfied reverie, as if to savour the moment for longer, though precisely what moment he savoured and why, Mr. Rubens would have found it hard to describe. Please ring the bell. Tap, tap, tap. If on that unseasonably warm October day he had been in any other room in the house, or if it had been colder and the thick velvet drapes that kept out the draught from the hallway had had to be drawn, he would almost certainly have missed the perfunctory knock on the front door. Tap, tap.
Insipid like a limp handshake,
he thought to himself, getting up from the amoeba and straightening his back before making his way in small and careful steps to see who it was.
All these racks, they'll be the death of you one day, mark my words.
He remembered his sister, Eunice Guernica Rubens, warning him on more than one occasion, as she stomped around his sitting room, pointing with disdain at the ever-growing multitude of crinkles, creases, and turned-up corners.
I mean, look at the state of them, Pablo. They're shabby and mangy like run-over carcasses riddled with lice. Get rid of them, for God's sake, before it's too late.
I'll have you know that 2 of them are rare Persian pieces. Extremely rare.
Mr. Rubens had always riposted to Eunice's theatrical gesticulations and dismissive rude noises. But although he had not heeded her advice and the rugs were all still there, crinkled and creased, corners turned up, if nothing else as a mark of respect for his sister, he now always manoeuvred around them as though traversing the most dangerous minefield. Tap, tap. Tap, tap. Insipid or not, as far as Mr. Rubens was concerned, impatience was rarely not impertinence and was always impolite. While he muttered to himself words of elderly indignation before opening the door, high above the frames of his strong varifocals, his pair of unkempt eyebrows, too predominantly black for his age, rose and fell, folding into crinkles like his rugs.
Yes?
Uniforms had always made him nervous, and as he tried to smooth his face, he worried he had sounded too testy.
Special delivery for Anthony Pablo Rubens, the postman answered in a monotone.
That's me?
Mr. Rubens confirmed with a hesitant smile.
Special delivery,
the postman repeated, handing Mr. Rubens a large brown envelope. His voice might be dull, but his uniform was clean, his tie well knotted, and his pencil moustache perfectly groomed. There had been some improvements, not even Eunice could have argued with that. Mr. Rubens may have never been particularly partial to moustaches, but this was a presentable young man who took pride in his appearance, and for that, he deserved to be commended. Not explicitly, perhaps. Any compliment might come across to him as lewd insinuation. He distinctly gave the impression of being very straight-laced. No doubt drummed into him at school as part of the more general indoctrination at the heart of the modern curriculum, it was apparently a quality demanded of all public servants. Mr. Rubens found it too militaristic. He couldn't help hoping that when he was off duty, the postman was more natural and able to relax and have fun, as all young people should. But in the world of New Britain in 2030, sadly, the reality was likely to be different.
Poor kid, thought Mr. Rubens. Even though he's barely out of his teens, he's probably been married off to a government party fanatic who's borne him two children already.
All the same, he was very good-looking. There was something very crisp about the symmetry of his features, also understated but accentuated by his cheekbones and somehow enhanced by the boy's total lack of expression. Yes, it was his boyishness Mr. Rubens found attractive more than anything else. Wooden like a still life of a young man at odds with his good looks, he reminded Mr. Rubens of himself in the early 1980s, almost half a century ago. While Mr. Rubens looked him up and down, from the tip of his cap to the pistol in the visible holster round his waist, all the way down to the luster of his polished black shoes, the young postman clung to his impassiveness tenaciously, staring straight ahead at nothing in particular as far as Mr. Rubens could tell, and certainly not looking Mr. Rubens up and down. Tall and trim, no heavier now than he had been in his 30s, and still able to maintain an erect, upright posture in spite of his age, Mr. Rubens towered over the postman by several inches, the young man's indifference barely grazing his shoulder as it flitted into several directions at once, magnified by Mr. Rubens' varifocals. Bowing his head just a trifle to the right, Mr. Rubens cleared his throat before pointing with a finger at the prominent sign that invited every caller to please ring the bell. It annoyed him that since he had put the sign up and his own sister had wired practically every room in the house with a separate buzzer, no one rang the bell anymore. The postman looked vaguely at the sign before turning back to face Mr. Rubens' varifocals with a squint.
He's got two rolling eyes and doesn't seem able to focus,
thought Mr. Rubens, now regretting he had made such an issue of the sign for the bell. But the postman seemed unfazed, handing Mr. Rubens a clipboard and pen, and this time a little bit louder, supposing perhaps that Mr. Rubens was deaf. He continued to look hither and thither as he spoke once again in a grueling monotone.
Number 5. Print name and sign in the box.
After signing for the letter and returning the clipboard and pen, whereupon the postman had saluted him unsmilingly by touching the tip of his cap, Mr. Rubens watched him disappear down the grey, deserted street with a clank of perfectly regular strides, as if marching to the drumbeat of a military band on parade after returning from the front, tired but triumphant. Mr. Rubens lived alone in a two-story house at the end of a long cul-de-sac, one of several in the periphery of Highgate Village. Astride one of its peaks that boasted greener green and an inevitability of subsidence that Mr. Rubens had soon learned to live with. Lining both sides of his street, the gnarled London plane trees had shed all their leaves, exposing their tangle of emaciated limbs as though proud to have been stricken with arthritis.
This ancient guard of honour's quaver contrasted with the unquestioning purposefulness of the uniformed youth cutting through it. As had always been the way of the world, something old was giving way to something new. The sheer strength of this impression stung Mr. Rubens with the pangs of an almost forgotten regret. Almost forgotten. Even if the past had contained it, he was uncertain whether or not he had felt it before. Perhaps the past had kept it well hidden, or perhaps, and Mr. Rubens considered this more likely, it too was something new.
But really, he should ask for an appointment at Moorfields and see an ophthalmologist, unless...
Snapping out of his melancholy brooding on the uncertainty of the past and pushing out preposterous thoughts, with long, deep breaths, Mr. Rubens filled himself with the invigorating chill that suddenly he had become aware of. Its sharp metallic tang, the harbinger of swiftly changing weather. That was something he knew the past had contained. Ever since he could remember, even as a young boy, he had been a more reliable forecaster of the weather than his father's Swiss barometer, or that blur of meteorologists' voices making their predictions on the wireless, all of them affecting excitement, as though they were broadcasting a reading of tea leaves. Air. Mr. Rubens could claim no known scientific basis for his gift, but he did know it had something to do with how the air would slowly seep into his consciousness once he had taken it deeply inside him, and a spontaneous weighing up of both its odour and its taste had occurred. As a matter of fact, his gift was not confined to forecasting the weather, or indeed to air he had inhaled outdoors. On his first train journey as a child, no sooner had he settled down beside his sister than he gulped with three big breaths the accumulated smell of passing crowds, in-breathing air filled with lives that each at different times had marked the drab interior with the momentary essence of a story. The air's musty staleness, as though dispersing vital particles of sadnesses and joys, had contained an embodiment of human endeavour, its cumulative instances permeating every surface, surviving the strongest detergents.
"I can smell all your secrets," he had once said to Eunice, leaning over her to take in her breath.
"No, you can't."
At first she was laughing at him, but as she rolled him around onto his back and climbed on top of him, getting ready to pinch his nose shut, the waft of her laughter betrayed her.
"Yes, I can, and if you hurt me, I'm going to tell."
"Tell what, you little liar? You've got nothing to tell."
He was flapping like a fish, trying to keep his nose out of her grip.
"Get off me, or I'll tell everyone about George Harrison and you'll be sorry."
His sister would have known exactly which George Harrison he was referring to. The older boy giving her French kissing lessons, not the Beatle.
"Whatever anyone's been saying, it's a lie, you hear?"
Spitting rage filled with more of the truth in his face, she was pushing down his shoulders so hard that little Anthony Pablo hadn't dared to contradict her.
"I believe you, I believe you, now get off me."
He must have been 11 or 12. She was 3 years older and strong.
"Not before you tell me who it was. Who told you this lie?"
"Ow, you're hurting me."
"Tell, tell, tell, or I'm going to hurt you more."
"My nose,"
he had wanted to say. But that would have been only half true. His nose had told him what she had been up to, but it hadn't told him who she had been up to it with. He had seen George Harrison winking at her at the fish and chip shop round the corner from school, but had thought nothing of it at the time. Only after getting a sniff of her breath had he put two and two together.
"No one told me, I swear. I saw him winking at you and I guessed."
"Well, you guessed wrong. Now say it."
"I guessed wrong. I guessed wrong."
From then on, he had kept his nose well out of Eunice's trysts, first with George Harrison and then with a rapid succession of boys with whom she would later be free, increasingly free, with her favours. He had kept his sister's secrets to himself by keeping his own under wraps. Things. After turning slightly colder tomorrow, the temperature would plummet to zero at the weekend. Then it would rain non-stop for 8 to 10 days. Before going back inside, Mr. Rubens reached for the doorbell. As the sound of Eunice's favourite symphony roared in the hallway, it occurred to him that he had no way of knowing if all the separate buzzers were in good working order. They had never been tested. It had taken Eunice an entire afternoon and a good part of the evening to install them, and in the end she had fallen asleep in the amoeba. That was the last Mr. Rubens had seen of his sister, more than 2 years ago now. She had stolen away in the middle of the night while he soundly slept upstairs in his bed, and 1 month later, she was dead, killed in the terrible fire that had burnt down her house in Belsize Park. Remembering his sister with fondness, Mr. Rubens did his best to console himself. The matter of the buzzers was hardly of importance. The bell, after all, never rang. Less. An earlier fleeting thought was forcing its way back. No, he could not have been mistaken. For 5 to 10 minutes, while they stood no further than inches apart, the young postman had exuded no scent. No whiff of anything at all had reached Mr. Rubens.
How strange, he thought. Unless
the postman had not been a boy, but a machine. Yes, a machine. Only a machine could have eluded his gift absolutely. The weather was a natural phenomenon, the air a vital sign that contained its foretelling. People, too, carried with them always their own unmistakable odour, in constant flux as it absorbed changing moods and emotions, telltale signs of all their secrets. Machines, on the other hand, were things, made up of dead substances and wires brought to life by pinprick microchips and electrical currents. Emboldened by the strong taste of anticipated rain that lingered at the back of his throat, and energized by the resurgence of memories and feelings for too long suppressed, Mr. Rubens had immersed himself in bold suppositions that perhaps were not so bold after all. His sister had needed no gift, nor a visit by an odorless postman, to predict them years before as the inevitable way of the future. A secret army of human simulacra, programmed by the state to do its bidding. As he closed the front door behind him, after shifting the envelope from one hand to the other, Mr. Rubens scrutinized it through his varifocals while he held it at arm's length. It was not particularly bulky or heavy, but unusually, it didn't bear a stamp. 2. Museum Service. Anthony Pablo Rubens had been selected for museum service, unless an application for exemption was made to the museum's ministry within 5 working days. A ministry official would be contacting him to arrange a convenient time for an evaluation panel to visit his home. Mr. Rubens liked museums. Naturally, he had never before been an exhibit himself, nor had he ever visited a people's museum. The prospect nevertheless filled him with immense excitement. The people's museums had been conceived expressly as a way for the state to honour and celebrate its citizens by putting them on public display for a day. And he, Anthony Pablo Rubens, was being summoned to be honoured and celebrated. The letter could not have been clearer. "Dear Mr. Rubens," it began, "you have been selected," etc. Did selected not imply recognition? Moreover, he had been selected for service at the National People's Museum, and as far as he knew, the National People's Museum was the showpiece of all the people's museums. The laws setting up the museum's ministry and introducing compulsory museum service and the people's museums had been passed quite some time ago now. Along with a swathe of new legislation introduced by the government party after its sweeping electoral victory. As the government party fulfilled one by one its far-reaching electoral promises, ranging from the abolition of trial by a jury of one's peers, to wholesale new restrictions on the flow of information, and culminating in the internment and eventual deportation of that section of the population stripped of its citizens' rights. One institution after another that had long been regarded elitist had been closed and then converted to a variety of alternative uses. Mr. Rubens had shared the gist, if not the vehemence, of his sister's indignation at many of the government party's reforms, including the closure of so many institutions that had once been the pride of the nation. But to be fair to the government party, the people had been consulted. Telephone polls had been conducted on an unprecedented scale in what the government party was still fond of describing as the largest exercise in direct democracy in the history of mankind, and millions of people had spoken. As part of this mammoth program of cultural restructuring, the capital's International Museum of Modern Art, which Mr. Rubens had visited on countless occasions, had closed and reopened as the country's National People's Museum. Naturally, the ideal would have been if the two could have stood side by side. Mr. Rubens readily acknowledged that, but that was democracy. Resources were limited and priorities had to be set. And the contents of IMMA, and of the other museums and galleries that had had to make way for the local people's museums, had not been destroyed. They had been carefully packed and stored away for safekeeping, in case the people one day changed their minds. It was true that most probably it had not been possible to salvage everything. One imagined that some of IMMA's more precarious exhibits, such as the butterfly and chocolate fountain that had stood in the atrium, or the huge ongoing installation made up of all manner of debris painstakingly collected from places laid waste to by war, which had been poignantly hailed by the critics as the 21st century's Guernica, might indeed have been lost, and naturally Mr. Rubens regarded this a matter of the most profound regret. But life had made him stoical.
At least we've still got cinema.
We've still got cinema to watch their propaganda.
It's not all propaganda. At the Curzon, they're still showing Almodovar.
Because apparently our new leader is a fan.
There's music at the new Albert Hall, kids have pop, and no one's burning books anymore. I honestly think that things are getting better all the time.
Pablo, listen to yourself. A mealy-mouthed apologist. That's what you're beginning to sound like.
I'm no one's apologist, Eunice, but this was what the people decided. No opera, no theatre, no art. It's what we used to call democracy, remember?
Democracy, my ass. Can't you see? These are all just clever ways to distract what's left of everyone's conscience, to make people forget what these thugs have done in their name, and your name, and mine, Pablo. Don't let's forget that.
They did what they promised to do, and they wouldn't have been able to do it if they hadn't won the election.
That doesn't stop them being thugs. And as long as they're in power, things are not getting better.
Victory. In a climate of fear and suspicion, the government party had won by a landslide. It had been a bitter victory, secured by angry votes. The 2020 virus pandemic had exhausted the world, but it had not united peoples or nations, and its aftermath of grief had proved a fertile ground for terror. Soon the helplessness against disease had given way to outrage and a craving for the certainties of overreaction. In 2023, an inconclusive early general election had led to a government of national unity that had failed either to govern or to unite. The newly formed government party's appeal was the comfort food of easy and deadly solutions. Openly inciting racial hatred, its leaders orchestrated violent riots in support of its outrageous demands, and in an effort to blunt its propaganda by exposing its presumed lack of widespread support, the government dissolved itself and called another early election in 2024, in which its various ineffectual parts once again campaigned against each other, practically refusing to acknowledge that the government party existed, let alone represented a credible threat. On the night of the election on Thursday, September the 11th, Eunice was with Mr. Rubens in Highgate, watching an election special on the one remaining channel of the BBC while waiting for the exit poll results to be announced at 10 p.m.
"What flavour are those crisps?"
Eunice asked.
"Salt and vinegar,"
answered Mr. Rubens, leaning forward in the amoeba as though to double-check. For this special occasion, bowls of savoury snacks and assorted crudités had been wheeled in from the kitchen on the stainless steel shelves of a trolley that had served in the Second World War as a battlefield repository for surgical equipment. Eunice scooped up a handful of the crisps, and Mr. Rubens watched as she crunched on them loudly.
"What's wrong?"
she said, when already she had dipped into the mix of Spanish olives without making use of a toothpick.
"Nothing," said Mr. Rubens.
"Are you sure? You've been looking at me sheepishly all evening. You haven't voted Tory, have you?"
"I voted Green, like I always do."
Eunice gave a sigh as she washed down the olives with an even bigger handful of crisps.
"They're all bloody useless," she said.
"That's more or less the government party's motto," said Mr. Rubens,
resisting the temptation to fetch the mini vacuum for her crumbs.
Filthy racist scum. At least they'll finally be trounced into oblivion tonight, whoever comes on top.
I wouldn't be so sure, said Mr. Rubens, taking off his glasses so he couldn't see the crumbs.
The latest opinion polls had given the Conservatives the slenderest lead, with government party support in single digits.
People aren't entirely stupid, said Eunice.
Let's hope you're right, said Mr. Rubens.
Turn the sound up, Pablo. It must be nearly 10.
Mr. Rubens gave his eyes a rub before putting his glasses back on to look at his watch.
5:02, he said. Let's see if they're more accurate this time.
In the previous election, the national exit poll had wrongly predicted an absolute majority for Labour. In the end, no single party had won overall control, hence the year of ineffectual coalition.
The talk around Westminster is of a late surge in support for the government party, with some reports even suggesting they're on course to hold the balance of power.
The BBC correspondent cleared his throat.
But with both main parties ruling out the possibility of sharing power with the government party, most pundits are predicting another grand coalition of national unity.
Grand my ass!
Eunice yelled at the TV. The camera cut to Big Ben.
The polls are now closed, and we join Martin Kingsley for the exit poll result.
The screen went momentarily black. Then the numbers appeared, and the mournful voice of Martin Kingsley read out the projected result. An outright win by the government party, with an absolute majority of between 90 and 110 seats. When the camera cut back to them, for a few seconds the BBC presenter and his guests seemed as stupefied as Eunice, and almost as pale.
I told you so.
Mr. Rubens felt like saying to his open-mouthed sister, but at the sight not so much of her teeth as of her colour, an off-white shade of off, he desisted.
Eunice? Are you all right?
That's bollocks. Those numbers are wrong,
she answered dryly.
People obviously lied, just to give the other parties a shock. Wait and see. Once the actual results are in, they'll be lucky to end up with more than a dozen MPs.
They're projected to have won almost 400, said Mr. Rubens. A dozen sounds a bit like wishful thinking.
Oh, Pablo, as if you've ever understood politics or people.
You're right, I haven't, said Mr. Rubens. But I do have a degree in mathematics.
There are unconfirmed reports of sporadic acts of violence and of rival crowds gathering in Parliament Square,
announced the BBC presenter.
We'll bring you more information as soon as we have it. In the meantime, Martin Kingsley is with a spokesman of the government party.
Mr. Avery, if the exit polls are accurate...
If is not in our vocabulary. If is for losers. No ifs, no buts, no more excuses. Our country is in crisis, Mr. Kingsley, and today all the true British people have voted for the party that was brave enough to offer them the only true solution.
No ifs, no buts, my ass, said Eunice.
Martin Kingsley adjusted his earpiece.
Reports are coming in of unprovoked attacks by armed government party supporters against members of religious and ethnic minorities. Perhaps you'd like to take this opportunity.
I'd like to take this opportunity to thank our supporters for putting their trust in the government party and for giving us a glorious victory against all the odds, a victory they've every right to celebrate.
Poof, talk about them counting their chickens.
Eunice snatched the remote from the arm of the amoeba and switched the TV off.
Come on, let's go.
Go where?
We'll take a minicab, but no, we should catch the bus to Archway and then get the tube. The roads might be blocked.
What roads?
Eunice had stood up and was pacing up and down.
And I doubt we'd find a minicab driver willing to take us, she said.
Take us where?
To join the protests, where do you think? We'll get off in Charing Cross and then we'll walk.
But what exactly are we protesting? If you're right and the exit polls are wrong.
Of course I'm right. But I wouldn't put it past those Nazi bastards to claim that they've been cheated. If there's one thing they're good at, it's coaxing people into actually believing their lies.
I thought you said people weren't stupid.
Being brainwashed isn't the same as being stupid.
When Mr. Rubens reluctantly agreed to join his sister and whoever wasn't brainwashed or stupid in a protest, the first real results had not yet been declared, allowing Eunice to cling on to hope. His neighbours, on the other hand, appeared to be taking no chances. Mr. Rubens' long cul-de-sac was deserted, and although it was not yet 11, all the houses were dark. In the gentle breeze, the leaves of the plane trees gave the murmur of a muffled tambourine, and the domes of dusty light that cascaded from the street lamps dotted the pavement with a curving line of shimmering halos. Even on the high street, there was hardly any traffic. Everywhere, the night was eerily still, the lights of the city giving in to the moon and the stars.
So many of them tonight, thought Mr. Rubens.
It was as if to make up for the half of the moon that was missing. A million new stars had been born to form a blanket of subdued illumination that lay softly over the city like a shroud. But then a silent flash of colourless fireworks tore into every part of the sky, and the moon and the stars disappeared. Light had travelled faster than sound. Eunice was checking her phone to see when the next bus was coming, when the road became the swell of a mob, surging, bulging, rolling as it swarmed its way downhill. Its barbarous chants and the sound of smashing glass shook the night, and hair-raising screams that were not those of fanatics rose above the mayhem to mark the beginning of darkness. Without either of them daring to speak, Mr. Rubens took his sister by the arm and led her away from the bus stop back in the direction of the house. In the air, the stench of burning rubber mixed with ugly human smells, filling Mr. Rubens with an overwhelming sadness that caused him to break into sobs. By morning, the exit poll result had been confirmed, catastrophically. If people had lied, they had lied to conceal their support for the government party, not to make it up. When all the votes had been counted, their victory was even greater than predicted, a whopping overall majority of 149 seats. All the other parties had been routed. Pablo. Given their family history, Mr. Rubens had always suspected that his sister might well have belonged to one of the few ineffectual underground movements that occasionally managed to daub anti-government slogans on government buildings.
"Don't ask," she would say,
perhaps just to tease him, or more likely than not, to protect him. Although unlike Eunice, and precisely because of their family history, Mr. Rubens had never become an overtly political person. This had not prevented him from having opinions or from privately expressing his strong reservations about some of the government party's more unorthodox policies.
"Extreme, Pablo. Let's call a bloody spade a spade. These people are murderers."
Was it possible for two contradictory truths to exist side by side? There was no getting away from the fact that today, long after the worst of the visible cruelties had stopped and the blackest hours had passed, the people seemed more than content with the new status quo. Almost everyone who had been ordered out of the country had found somewhere to go, and most of the camps had been dismantled. There was no longer much appetite for conflict and controversy. Some kind of consensus had at last been achieved. For all Mr. Rubens' regret at any injustices, and there must have been many, was it not, as he had rather convincingly once said to his sister, some vindication of its radical program that within just a few years of its coming to power, all the old parties had either disbanded or merged with the government party? Abroad, too, hadn't increasing numbers of countries across every continent followed the government party's example? Was this not proof that the government party's solution, if not a perfect solution, was the only solution there was? Had his sister forgotten that for years one outrage had followed another, causing discord with carnage and huge devastation until finally people had snapped? Eunice had offered no arguments. Instead, she had embraced him and called him a fool.
"Oh, Pablo, Pablo."
She had always insisted on calling him Pablo, more often than not, Mr. Rubens suspected, as a means of rousing what little she thought might have been left of his conscience. For himself, Mr. Rubens couldn't help thinking that Pablo and Guernica were names that Ernest had given his children to honour their grandfather's cruel, irresponsible folly. Harry Rubens had travelled to Spain to fight in a country that wasn't his own because of a painting. Without a second thought, he had left his pregnant wife alone in a country that wasn't her own.
"It wasn't because of a painting,"
Eunice had always protested.
"He went to fight for the cause that had brought them together. It wasn't his war."
"It was everyone's war. Remember what actually happened in Guernica, Pablo."
Guernica wasn't a painting. It was a town bombed by the Nazis and a slaughter of innocent people. Martyr Beatrice was glad that he went.
How do you know that? Did she say that she was? Did anyone ask her?
Mr. Rubens very much doubted if anyone had. He was certain that his grandmother, whose country had taken already the lives of her parents and both of her brothers, would have rather her husband had stayed where he was.
Men are selfish. They always do what they want. And it's always the women who pick up the pieces. They are the heroes. What good did it do that he went?
He went to join the fight against Franco and fascism.
And was ambushed unarmed at the border, killed before firing a shot, buried who knows where. Can you imagine how Martyr Beatrice must have felt? Because I can.
No, Pablo, you can't. And instead of being so ready to judge them, maybe you should try and be more like the brave men you accuse of being selfish.
Whatever the cause, and Mr. Rubens would not have denied Eunice's claim that the cause had been just. Their grandfather's actions had blighted the lives of the people he loved without ever touching the lives of the people he had wanted to fight for. Who had he wanted to fight for? Enemies were easier to pinpoint than trustworthy comrades. His sister might have thought him naive and self-centered, perhaps even a coward, and he had never made the slightest attempt to discourage, if anything, he had encouraged, judgments he himself had allowed to become so entrenched. But the reality, he liked to think, was rather different. He was not as uninformed as Eunice had always assumed. It was just that he had never been as able as his sister to imagine a world so stark and clear-cut in its contrasts. The pencil moustache. With his mother gone and his father a distant figure, as a child, Mr. Rubens had withdrawn into himself, close only to Martyr Beatrice and his sister. But discovering and then embracing his sexuality had made him social. The young man with the pencil moustache who had irritated him by not ringing the bell had not been a robot. What had duped Mr. Rubens' senses was not any inorganic composition, but on the contrary, the postman's striking resemblance not to Mr. Rubens himself, as had been his initial impression, but to another young man with a pencil moustache, to whom he owed the solitary love of his life.
Joe, but you can call me Joe.
The postman had reminded Mr. Rubens of the moment when he realized he had fallen in love. 3. Malcolm. It was the early 1980s. With a degree in mathematics and a dull job in the civil service devising methods of manipulating numbers, in other words, compiling statistics for a government he loathed, Anthony took every opportunity of waxing his thick head of hair into a quiff and joining Malcolm, who worked in the same department, in his room in King's Cross, from where they walked together to the Bell. It was an almost nightly pilgrimage, and it lasted through the war in the Falklands and a second election win for Margaret Thatcher, right up until the summer of 1984, when for Anthony and Malcolm, it ended.
Where will it end? Where will it end?
Joy Division asked night after night, long after Ian Curtis had decided on an answer.
When you're in love and you know you're in love.
Phil Oakey and the Human League were right about that, and wrong about it too. When you're in love, sooner or later, you know you're in love.
I'm in love.
In the years before he moved out of the house he and Eunice had grown up in, to a studio flat in Vauxhall with the views of the derelict Battersea Power Station, Anthony had lost count of just how often Eunice had come home in the morning after sleeping with whoever she had met the night before. To utter those same words with a passion no amount of repetition had been able to diminish. Long gone were the days when only through his nose would Anthony uncover the secrets of Eunice's nocturnal assignations.
I'm in love.
His sister had exclaimed time after time, year after year, often in a twirl around the objects in his finely furnished home. Every weekend, come rain or shine, Anthony would get out of bed, run water through the ramshackle ruins of his quiff, and begin his expedition to the markets. Camden Lock for 50s kitsch and the odd piece of mid-century furniture, Portobello and Camden Passage for Art Deco, and Brick Lane for bric-a-brac, humble precursors to the heights of his rarefied taste in interior design. In the end, while leaning back in a rickety Charles Eames to contemplate a chipped Clarice Cliff, Anthony had formed the firm belief that,
I'm in love,
was just a shell of empty words serving as a euphemism for a life of promiscuity and wild abandon. And if it suited his sister, mightn't it also suit him? It didn't. Soaking up the atmosphere of camaraderie and general licentiousness filled him with a sense of freedom he had never felt at home, but it failed to stop him feeling an apartness that increasingly he imagined as his destiny. Every awkward attempt to break away from it had gone awry, every casual encounter cut short. Not once had he been tempted, even insincerely, to utter the words, "I'm in love." The alternative gay scene was small and incestuous in those days, and almost everyone Anthony knew had slept with someone who had slept with almost everyone else. That someone just so happened to be Malcolm. The life of the party and the soul of indiscretion, he knew Anthony's secrets long before his best friend had confided them to him. On the evening of July 15th, a Sunday in the summer of 1984, Anthony was failing to get comfortable as he lay across the sofa in Malcolm's room watching Malcolm get ready, swinging this way and that, striking playful poses while staring at himself in a tall piece of mirror that was propped against the wall. Buzz and vibe. Roughly 18 hours earlier, Anthony and Malcolm had parted on the dance floor to the Gang of Four's disjointed, damaged goods. They had met again in the morning, too early after a late night that for both of them had started but not ended at the bell. At 8 o'clock sharp, while clutching a watery takeaway tea, Anthony was waiting for Malcolm on the opposite side of the high street outside Camden Town Station. At 8:15, he took one last sip and disposed of the styrofoam cup while it was still half full. Less than 5 minutes later, wearing jeans and a surplus sailor's t-shirt, white and navy blue, Malcolm spilled out of the station in a glut of new arrivals. Teenage punks sporting colourful mohicans, gangly students carrying instruments for busking, white-robed evangelicals heading for church. Malcolm stood out in a crowd even from a distance, his physical presence taking possession of space and defining it entirely as he cut his way through it, displacing air while at the same time somehow filling it with an intangible translucence. Whereas Anthony's gift seemed to always cast life in a shadow, Malcolm's was to inundate its mysteries with light. Already under his spell, which had nothing to do with sexual attraction, Anthony caught Malcolm's eye and crossed the road to greet him.
"You're late again," he said. "You're always late."
Malcolm crushed him in a bear hug.
"Don't, I've got a headache,"
he said. Pulling back, he wiggled his long fingers as he dug them into Anthony's hair, running them through it as though stroking a tune along a piano keyboard.
"Your hair looks as bad as I'm feeling."
In the company of his friend, Anthony's experience of the world was suffused with a sense of belonging that it otherwise lacked. He loved Malcolm's ease and the naturalness and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.